Okay, we're going to get started with today's NCBI Minute. Thank you for coming today. Let me just put in a plug for our YouTube channel. If you subscribe to our channel, you can get updates of all the videos we put up on YouTube, including other tutorials. In terms of the format of this webinar, our speaker today, Kim Pruitt, is going to be showing you some slides about updates to prokaryotic genome annotation. If you have questions during that, go ahead and put those into the question pod. Some of those could be answered while Kim is talking. Others, we may answer when she's finished with the slides. Kim will answer those. And others yet, we will put in a document on the courses and webinars page at NCBI under materials where you can see a log more or less of the questions and answered. These slides today are already up on this materials link at the bottom of the slide you're seeing right now. That goes to the NCBI FTP site. So without further ado, I'll introduce Kim Pruitt to talk about updates to prokaryotic genome annotation.
Okay, thank you, everybody. I'm Kim Pruitt, and I'm the person who's in charge of RefSeq eukaryotes and prokaryotes. And if you're not familiar with RefSeq, in a nutshell, it is an NCBI project to provide reference sequence standards that incorporate current knowledge for genomes, transcripts, and proteins. It's a very large data set, but today I'm going to talk to you about some of the new features in our prokaryotic genomes. So just to get started, I want to give you a sense of how we create our genomic records. These are made basically from the submitted data that's coming into GenBank or our partner databases in the INSDC, which is the International Nucleotide Sequence Database Consortium, our collaboration. So you as the submitter community do a lot of work to generate genome sequence data, to annotate, to assemble that into the genome sequence that is submitted to NCBI. In some cases, you're annotating that data yourselves, or you're taking advantage of NCBI's genome annotation service for prokaryotic genomes. All of that information gets submitted to GenBank, and it's available in our nucleotide and protein resources. Sometimes the raw data is available in SRA. The information about the assembly itself is available in NCBI's assembly resource, and metadata about the sample that was used and about the specific research project are available also in our metadata databases. The sequence data and the assembly information is then copied into the RefSeq project, where we are then carrying out a whole genome annotation process. This is something that has changed recently in the prokaryotic world. We used to propagate annotation from the submitted GenBank entry and only annotate those that did not have any annotation, but now we are annotating all prokaryotic genomes using our annotation pipeline. This offers us a lot of improvement in terms of consistency of the annotation and in terms of being able to update them in a more timely fashion, because some submissions come in and they're never updated further to reflect new information. And so in our pipeline, we can do those kind of updates. So I'm not going to go into the details about our pipeline on the previous slide that I'm sorry I moved away from too quickly. There was a link to find more documentation about the pipeline process flow itself. So our management of the proteins that we annotate on prokaryotic records has changed significantly in the past couple of years. The original model that we were using was that for any given assembled genome, and so the accession prefixes on the top are two of the accession prefixes that we use for genomic sequence records. For any given genome, we used to provide a distinct accession number, which I'm showing here with a YP accession prefix, for each annotated coding region on that genomic sequence. So the little pinkish boxes are coding regions, and the individual accessions would be applied per genome. So if you had two isolates of E. coli from two patients in a hospital, we would be providing separate accession numbers for both of those. So there was no way to correlate easily that the sequences were actually identical at the protein level, and we were having a huge increase in redundancy in the RefSeq dataset. And so we undertook a massive shift in our data model to address the redundancy issue. We went through an intermediate stage where we had our original accession numbers cross-linking to our new, truly non-redundant RefSeq protein data set. And these currently have an accession number prefix that begins with a WP. So if you see an accession WP followed by underscore, you know you're looking at a truly non-redundant RefSeq protein record. Our current model, which is the completion of our transition in our protein management, is that all of our bacterial and archaeal records are directly annotated with the non-redundant protein record. So what this means is, for a given CDS, let's say the first one on my picture here, if this protein is identically found in five other genomes from the same or different species, then we annotate all six of those genomes with the exact same accession number. So there will be six genomes that are providing cross references to this identical protein sequence. So we've significantly reduced the redundancy in our protein data set. You can see some of the actual measures of that redundancy in our documentation page. The link is shown at the bottom of this page, where you just plug in the NCBI root URL here. So this offers us an advantage in terms of redundancy management, but it also has had a very positive secondary benefit in giving us a really good way to manage protein names. We can now manage protein names directly on this level of non-redundant protein records without having to re-annotate the genome. We can update the protein record to offer an improved protein name, and that improved protein name is automatically propagated to the genomes that protein is annotated on. This is a really strong advantage to this data model. Along the way, we've also added some categorizations to RefSeq prokaryotes. So we now categorize them as reference genomes. We have a small number of reference genomes. These are the highest quality complete genomes that are supported by curation, either at NCBI by NCBI staff scientists or through communities that we collaborate with. So there's greater confidence in the sequence of these genomes and in the annotation on these genomes. And I'm just giving you an example here. In my examples, in all three cases here, the first identifier is to NCBI's assembly database, where you can get metadata about the quality of the assembly. The second identifier is the RefSeq genome accession number, and then followed by the species name. We also have a category called representative genomes, and what we're trying to do is select a representative per species. Most of these representatives are high-quality complete genomes, but some of these are draft, and what we're trying to do is select the best genome available at this point in time. These are subject to change over time as we get more genome sequencing data. And for lack of a better word, we're currently calling the remainder our variant genomes. The majority of these represent bacterial species for which there have been thousands and thousands of sequences submitted for the same organism. So we may have thousands of E. coli genome submissions, thousands of Salmonella genome submissions, and these are really defining variants of this species. You can find information about these categories, reference or representative, by searching our assembly resource. And here's an example query to find RefSeq reference genomes. So this is a picture, a screenshot of one of our non-redundant protein records. And you can see it has the WP accession number showing up here on the record. I want to point out that these records are annotated at the lowest common denominator in terms of what organism information they carry. So if there is in this case, this is an extreme case. This is something that is annotated on genomes of different species where the lowest common denominator of those species is bacteria. And so that is the organism information that is carried on this sequence record. You might find others that are carrying organism information at the level of the genus. And of course, there are still many that carry organism information at the level of the species. There's more information about the non-redundant protein sequences available online. And at the top of the page is the URL to that documentation. At the bottom of the page is the URL to the specific protein record that I'm showing you here. Very recently, we've added a database that is being used to manage protein names. And so within that database, we have stored all of the protein names that are currently used for our non-redundant protein records. We have stored all of the SwissProt protein names. We are collecting and generating a large data set of HMMs. We are doing protein clustering. We are looking at identical proteins, and we are curating names. And so we are embarked in the past couple of months on a very massive initiative to improve the protein names on these records and to standardize the way we're formatting our protein names on these records. And so you should look for improvements to continue to come through the course of this year. And I can't spend too much more time on this. I think I'm over my webinar 10 minutes, but if you'll bear with me for a couple more minutes, this is a picture of a new webpage display called the Identical Protein Report. You can get to this from any protein record. There's a link at the top of the page in the same location as the GenPEP FASTA graphics link shown here to access this page. This is a very useful page. It tells you how many genomes a given protein record was annotated on. In this case, I've boxed 3. So this same protein accession number has been annotated on 3 different RefSeq genomes. The accessions are shown here, and the coordinates of the annotation are shown here. The organism information is shown in the column to the right, and so you can see that these are 3 very different bacterial organisms, and the lowest common denominator for these is at the bacteria level. In some cases, this may be an indicator that there was a problem in identifying the correct organism for a submission, but in other cases, this is really reflecting very interesting biology. And last but not least, in the process of converting to our new data model, there was an awful lot of suppression that happened. We suppressed the intermediate level of records, the YP and NP accession numbers on all of our representative and variant genomes. I just want to make a note that for the reference genomes, they continue to use the data model where there is an independent accession defined for the reference genomes. For those records that were suppressed, we have provided a custom message on those records. So if you go to this URL, you will see a very informative message provided that tells you that this accession that has been suppressed has indeed been replaced by a non-redundant protein record. And then you can navigate to that protein record, to the identical protein report, or to documentation about our re-annotation project. And last, there is a comprehensive mapping file provided for those who would like to have a comprehensive report by FTP. This file is available in the RefSeq release catalog directory. This was put out in the beginning of this month. In July, when we process our next RefSeq release, this file will be moved into the release catalog archive directory where it will continue to be available. This file provides mapping between the old suppressed protein accession number to the alive non-redundant protein accession that is replacing it. It also maps old locus tags to new locus tags. We had to annotate our genomes with new locus tags because we are now providing de novo genome annotation for all of our records, and there are some new genes that are being called. So we cannot rely on existing locus tags that may have been submitted. It also reports information on gene ID mapping for people who are interested in that information from NCBI's gene resource. And I would just like to thank people who have done all of the work on these changes. If you have questions, you can look at the online documentation that I provided links to in these slides. You can also look at our FAQ, or you can contact us at either info@NCBI or webinars@NCBI to follow up with questions. Thank you. So the question is, what is the source of the annotations qualifiers attached to the non-redundant protein entry, and what is the procedure if I have a question about that annotation? So are you talking about, I'm not sure exactly what you mean by qualifiers. Are you talking about the organism information, the protein name, or something else? Oh, the product. So you're talking about the protein name. So initially the source was what came in from GenBank. NCBI has been working on protein clustering and naming things that are similar by homology for a couple of years. In the beginning of March, we created this new name management database that really gives us a lot of power to improve our protein names. And we have already improved about 1.2 million protein names. And this is an area that we are extremely actively working on. So if you have specific name examples, then yes, please send them, or specific names that are bad, then yes, please send that information to us. We're very, very interested in improving the quality of the names on our non-redundant protein records. And you can use the info at NCBI email to contact us for that.
Okay, that looks like all of the questions. If you think of something else, go ahead and send those to the webinars at NCBI email address, and we'll get those included in the documentation for this webinar. Thank you very much. We're going to sign off now, and we'll see you at the next NCBI Minute. Goodbye.